Knox Box. Everything you need to get your game from the box to the board.
Hey guys, welcome to a very late at night Knox Box. I am Knock himself, with me this evening, morning, time, indiscriminate time period.
Again.
Cordial Rob.
Good evening.
We have just come back from an amazing day out.
We've been to Nottingham. We have just returned from the Mantic Open Day.
It was really good. We're big Mantic fans. You've probably seen our Marstax unboxing. We play Dead Zone in the store. We play Dreadball. And so we went up. We were invited up to the Mantic Open Day. Really kind of them. Big shout out to Mark. Great guy. He invited us up. We had a look around. We didn't really know what to expect, did we?
We've been looking at the current, some of the Mantic Kickstarters lately, so you've supported the Martian one.
Absolutely.
And we've been looking at the Kings of War one.
Absolutely, yeah, that's the latest one.
You were a bit sceptical about that one.
Yes, because to me it was just, well, that's Warhammer Fantasy, isn't it? It's not. I can now say, for 100% honesty, it is nothing like Warhammer Fantasy. It's streamlined, it's quick, and it's fun.
Dice rolling. Anyway, and great big buckets.
It's late at night and we're already waffling and going off topic.
We apologise.
At the open day, you're greeted straight away with a goodie bag. The moment you walk through, you're given free scenery in there. You got the whole rule book for Kings of War.
Version 1.
Version 1, yeah, because version 2 is still in progress. And then
a few models.
Yeah, models as well.
So that
really
was
good.
Rebels and Marauders.
Yeah.
We've tossed them at Miguel.
Yes, he's our resident Dead Zone guy.
Yep.
So you walk through the door, you're handed this bag straight away, and then it's a room full of gaming. You've got a table for Mars Attacks.
Dreadball.
Many Dreadballs, including the new Dreadball Extreme, which we had a go at, and we picked up the retailer pledge, so if you're down in Knox Boxes next weekend, you will be seeing it. That's going to be amazing. So Dreadball Extreme, normal Dreadball, Mars Attacks.
Dead Zone.
Kings of War. Loka, because they have that tie-in with...
Loka board game and the Tower of Loka.
Yep.
There was their digital applications manual.
Yes, it's
that was very interesting.
Now, all of this we will talk about in more detail later on. In another one. But tonight...
Just a quick recap.
Yeah, show you what's there. And that was all the main room. Then they had a retail room. Where they had amazing show deals, as you would expect. I think it was three for two, even, on everything.
Yes.
Unbelievable.
So they had all their large Kings of War box sets. They had T-shirts, Martians, signed comic books for the Martians.
Yeah, they did. Everything you could want.
Yeah.
And then the bit that I really went up for, I say the panels, but it's the Q&A that they do. So you can go into a room with, obviously, other guests, and then you've got Ronnie.
Yeah.
And... Name's going to escape me, and he's going to kill me. I will look it up.
He's going to kill you.
He is going to kill me. The man who is behind Dreadball, behind Dead Zone, he is the guy. And I apologise profusely.
He needs his coffee.
I do need my coffee. It's like 1 in the morning. But we went into the Q&A, and it was really, really informative. So now, here is, I think, an hour-long video. The whole Q&A start to finish.
And we each managed to ask a question.
We did manage to ask a question. It's really good. So we've got loads of stuff to unbox from the day. And we've got loads of stuff to recap on and amazing news and hints and all sorts. But tonight we will leave you...
Somebody bought every army in Dreadball Extreme. That will take a while.
Don't tell my wife. We'll leave you with the video. We will see you another time.
Until next time. Good morning.
Yeah. Hey guys, this is Knoxbox. We're at the Mantic Open Day up in Nottingham. With me today is Knock himself. We have Miguel Boonaboo. Apparently that's his name. And Cordial Rob.
Here again.
A special guest, Andy as well.
Who's doing our photography.
So, what are we waiting for, guys? What are we queuing for?
We are waiting for the Mantic Games Seminar. Here's one of the
players. Oh, there's Mark. He's fantastic. He looks after our trade account.
So, we've had our goodie bag. We have some new models that you'll be seeing in the future, which James will be looking forward to.
Absolutely.
We're hopefully after this having a demo of the Kings of War, because we've had a look at that, so So all units hit, all units removed. It doesn't matter how you model them now, because they're altering the rules as tight. We've seen some of the models.
Oh, and here's Ronnie himself. Get a sneaky picture of limboing Ronnie.
We've seen some of the models for the Mars attacks. We've had a look at the Loka game system. And we've had a game of that. We've had a look at the Tower of Loka. We've seen some of the new models for, as I said, the Enforcers. And we've seen some of them up and painted. So we'll put some of those pictures up on the Facebook, I expect.
But look at Dreadpool Extreme.
Yes. Oh. You'll hear a lot of ranting about that from Nock, as he does a lot of squealing.
Oh, and now we are going in.
Start the seminar.
Right.
Depends on how warm people don't mind being.
Is everyone alright? Nobody's dying. Nobody's really going to tell me if they're dead or they're
not. Everyone is dead. Speak up.
That's the squeeze. Don't squeeze anyone. I'm going to try and get that fire. I'm going to go get the man himself.
Yeah, okay. So, I was going to do questions, because I have no idea which of the games you were more interested in knowing about. There's more time it would take me to explain everything than we have time to talk to you before people start expiring. So, questions that aren't about white boxes on the shelf.
Dungeon Saga.
Right,
you've tweaked a few things, yes, from the original Dwarf King's Hold games.
Yeah.
Are you going to go back and bring them into, update them games so this matches the system?
I think not. I think, well, what we're doing with Dungeon Saga is it effectively is a replacement for the original Dwarf King's Hold. And we've got, we're going to do the sort of classic series where we take all the scenarios out of the original Dwarf King's Hold and we do an updated Dungeon Saga version of those. Hello.
I was going to let you do this by yourself.
That's fine.
Do you want me to stay, should I go?
Stay, because you're giving me extras to do.
So what we're doing with that is we're basically replacing Dwarf King's Hold, because there'll be once we've taken all of the good bits out of it, there'll just be a couple of scraps left, and there's no need to have both of them at the same time.
Great, so that means my first edition copy is going to be worth a few bucks in a few years' time.
Get it on
eBay! save it, let everybody else put it on eBay, and then when it's fallow... Yes, so all the scenarios from there will be done as a new Dungeon Saga version, to classic.
I think that was one of the stretch goals, wasn't it?
Yes.
Yeah.
You said confidently. Anything else? Any questions?
No? Another big plan for Project Pandora then?
Project Pandora, well, ignoring the fact Ronnie's sitting here, it would be nice to do both a Dungeon Saga equivalent with the science fiction and a fantasy version of Dead Zone. No. Both things I'd like to do. They're both interesting projects that would, I think, work very well. It's just a case we can't do everything at once, and there's sort of some point down the line. Because we've got, we're revisiting Dead Zone. As far as I'm revisiting Dead Zone, I think next, unless that's moved again.
No.
No, that's not moved again. No. It was Dead Zone Redux was going to be the slot that Kings of War is in now, and then it got kind of moved around. But originally it was going to be Warpath, so it's a movable feast. So yes is the idea. We will redo that. I mean, Pandora was interesting because Pandora was the last thing we did before Kickstarter kind of changed the way everything worked. And I think because it was the last thing we did at that slot, it didn't get the support it would traditionally have had if Kickstarter had never happened. So the world changed slightly in the way you produce stuff, and so everybody went, oh, what's this new thing? How does this work? And
the plastic were also less friendly towards board game playing. I thought that vermin bag of plastics was just a bit complex. It was a bit hard to get to stick together and stuff. So, nice model, but getting them from bag to board was quite complex. Whereas, Dreadball Extreme is.
That was a kind of concept shift in how Mantic looked at board games. Because originally it was a case of take the existing things we'd already made and make a game out of those resources. So it was the plastics had already been tooled, which were designed for gamers to build armies to play Kings of War, not for families to take out the box and put on the table. in a board game. So it's a different kind of concept. So again, Pandora, again, suffers slightly from that in terms of being a board game product. But plenty of war gamers play board games, so you know there's lots of crossover. So it's not that there's nobody, it's just a smaller market and a different market. So I think in its next incarnation, when we revisit Pandora, whenever we get to it, it will be kind of Dungeon Saga equivalent in terms of mechanics and presentation and kinds of things that are in it. So it will be models you get that come pre-assembled and are in different colours for different factions and so on, all that kind of stuff.
Moonbase Saga.
Pardon?
Moonbase Saga.
Moonbase Saga, yes. Any more?
When the Dungeon Saga Kickstarter was running, there was some mention about, downtime.
Yes.
From the game, like another aspect of the game.
Yes.
Another stage. Is there anything you can tell us more about that?
Downtime? Okay, downtime is in the... If I sort of say that there's two basic sets of Dungeon Sagas, the core part, which is the fight against Mortibris, a series of linked narrative scenarios, and that part is proscriptive. It tells you how things are going to do. Set this up exactly in this way, with exactly these monsters, exactly these heroes, with exactly this equipment. This is exactly how you need to win, and it's set up completely for you. So you just take it out of the box, do what it tells you. The expansion, the call it advanced rules to distinguish it from expansion, but it's
adventurous different. Companion.
Adventurous companion, that's what it's called today.
Yeah.
The adventurous companion is a sandbox of stuff you can do with that kind of concept around that game, and it's a lot of choice. So instead of being proscriptive, it says, here's a bunch of stuff, do what you like. So one of those things is a campaign system. Because we're going to have a how to write your own scenarios, so you design your own scenarios, and then how you build your own characters, and how you experience those characters, how they gain experiences that go through adventures, and how you link campaigns together. And downtime is part of linking campaigns together. It's the bit between the scenarios. So you have a scenario that you do stuff, and you achieve your goals or you don't, and then you have an element of downtime, then you have another scenario, an element of downtime, and so on. It goes on, off like that. The idea of downtime is to include some elements and some sort of tastes of the idea of role-play games without the complexity and the investment required in terms of time and effort building whole worlds. So it's a very simple idea that between two scenarios you get some sort of bookkeeping stuff you have to do, but there is a choice. You can do one thing. You can go to the pub and carouse with your mates. You can go down the market and see what you can find. You can go to the priest and get his blessing. You could go to the temple and sacrifice some stuff you've just taken from the tombs, dungeons, wherever you've been, and you can offer it to the gods. Maybe they'll give you some blessing. Who knows? So there's a bunch of different things you can do, some of which would be better for some characters than others, some of which may be required by some characters at certain times. But that gives you a spin on whatever happens that you have for your next adventure, or how your character develops, or how your character finds new items, or gains new equipment, or sells the stuff he's got to get more gold, or any number of other permutations. So at different times in your character's development, and depending on what your character is, they may choose to do different parts of downtime. But again, it becomes a resource. You can spend, between adventures, you can do one thing. And the intention is you will always want to do at least five. So all of them are useful. Which one do I want to do? Do I want more money? Do I want a better skill? Do I want to have a blessing so when I'm next to fight I don't die so fast? Do I want a new shiny magic item? And so on. So does that answer the question?
It does.
It does. Good. So it's depending on which choices you make and which type of character you've got and how you choose to advance and also, it can make a wider selection of different heroes.
What's the lead time for the Adventurous Companion from the main set?
The lead time?
Yeah, so the main set comes out, how long before the Adventurous Companion comes out?
To Kickstarters or to trade?
Right.
The Kickstarters will be, obviously...
The same time?
Yeah, because I think it's one shipment Time for Kingdoms so I think Dungeon Saga is a one ship.
Yeah, I didn't know if you, I couldn't remember if you were going to do it in waves, like.
Yeah. No, I think we're trying to.
I think the intention was it.
It'll end up being in two boxes. No, it's definitely been two boxes because it's too heavy for one box. So there'll be some delay, and that will obviously pick up the one thing that goes wrong. You just don't know what it is yet, but there will be something.
Yeah, it depends on which where the thing that goes wrong is.
But
if that's part of the core set, then the great, then you know, all one shipment. If it's something that's supposed to happen late in the expansion or whatever, then.
So I'm thinking at the moment what you're going to be getting is the launch is going to be Dungeon Saga, because it isn't actually. It's quite a lot of sculpts, 96 sculpts. I think we've done there's 6 or 8 tools in it. Yeah, seems about that.
Three expansions as well, remember?
Yeah. So
not counting the.
Yeah.
You're going to get
Adventurous Companion.
The Dungeon Saga, the main game. What am I meant for that? Is that Dungeon Saga?
Yes.
Revenge of Mortimer's.
Yes, Ronnie.
Okay.
Stay on target, Red Pine.
There's only going to be actually three types of expansion. The first one is going to be you've got your dwarf, elf, wizard, and barbarian. They're going to tool through their scenarios and at the end meet and eventually beat Mortibris when you've played them all the way through and you've got to that point.
You say. My money's on Mortibris. He's hard.
Yeah, over time, respawning. Game. You ran out of ammo, go and do it again.
Yeah.
Eventually you'll get to the end and get bored, but Mortibris will flee. You're not there to kill him, but he's not going to have that cool uber magic item that would have meant the end of the world. Actual fact, the first expansion we're going to put out will be continuing that story, and in fleeing, Mortibris will raise Bael the undead demon and say, go, give those a bit of a kicking if you don't mind, and then maybe you'll meet Mortibris at the end of that again. So if you love those heroes and you love that storyline and you maybe played it through with your group or with your boy or whatever, or your boys and girls, you get to that point, you think, should we just carry on? They're fully tooled up, they're really tough, I love those guys, here's one more run with them. So that's going to carry on straight down the line, which I think will be good fun. And we can have them uber hard. So you've got really tooled up heroes. The next one is we know you're going to have the game. And then you're going to have, right, take two of those heroes and two new heroes that are in this expansion of the Abyssal. And you're going to fight a load of stories, start a whole new story arc with these four characters now there. So perhaps that might be a prequel. So two of the heroes are in there and they become in that story. We haven't kind of spec that, but it will be a clean new story where you start with a level one hero again. Four level one heroes, but it'll be very different because you're fighting different foes and you're fighting with two different new heroes. So it'll really change the dynamics.
If you're mixing up two of the original ones with two different ones, depending on which selection you take, it makes a huge difference.
And we'll do that a couple of times. You've got the greenskin story. Now, you do not need to have the abyssal one to play the greenskin one. It will be, we assume you've got the game. Now you can play it with abyssals. Now I can play it with the greenskins.
Dragon.
The dragon one, don't know about that one. You might need the others. That might be the final kind of story. We'll play with that. But you've still got a load of undead, so it could be undead leading to a dragon anyway. But we'll play with that one. But those are prescriptive, really. You don't need to think, you can just set it up, know it's balanced and have a load of fun.
Don't need to think. I'm sorry. Please excise that for more podcasts.
What I mean is, well, you don't need to think, you don't need to spend hours picking your thingies and your team, and you don't want to write any scenarios.
You set up the way we tell you, and then you think when you're playing.
Correct. You don't need to think, if you're not really interested,
you don't need to
think before you start playing.
Yes.
That's what I was going to say before I so rudely interrupted. and then the third angle, which is not in any way linked to either of those two, is what Jay was talking about, which is the Adventurous Companion. And that is the sandbox, open it up, and if you like being the dungeon master, write some dungeons. Hey, you know, I really love that game, I love the way it played, I want to do loads of this. And I think there is in a lot of groups someone that wants to be the dungeon master. There's others who want to get a party together, and it isn't role-playing, but it's as close as you can get with miniatures, I think, and it can be a fun visit it weekly. You know, we'll put out Bags of Undead and Abyssals, and that's also where we'll open up the whole range of Kings of War. So you want to add trolls, you want to add this, you want to add that, go and use your soldiers and plop them across. Yeah, it's all 28mm, it's all just there.
The Adventurous Companion has bestiaries for the undead, the Abyssals, the dwarves, the elves, all the ones that were in the original Dwarf King Hull series, the bestiaries are in there, together with any other random odds and ends from the...
Yeah, so it'll be really fun.
There's quite a lot of stuff in
build
there.
Build your own.
Building your own stuff.
And tool up. It. So you can play in different ways, but they're going to be really... That should cover, you know, everybody that likes playing with, you know, toy soldiers.
It'll certainly give you a couple of thousand hours of playtime, so if that's not worth you...
£100, yeah, 60 quid.
Or whatever it was, I don't know, I mean...
And it was lovely with that Kickstarter that, you know, there were 6,000 backers, our biggest ever number. But it meant, you know, it was $100 down on our average, yet the total was higher than, you know, it was our second highest ever. Which is really good, because we want to spread that load out, you know. I think a lot of, a small number of people have carried Mantic a long, long way. Mm. And we appreciate that, but we don't So, but you know, it's great, it means that we're getting out, our message is getting out, more and more people are joining. Which is wonderful, but it is nice. And the same with Kings of War at the moment, that pledge level is about 117. Oh. It's Jake's games today.
Sorry. Ronnie's got 3-7 off to ramble in, but I've only got one.
Okay.
Are there any more questions about Dungeon Sagas or anything else?
Yeah. What's your sort of, I know obviously it funded like crazy and we've got all these expansions, but is there a vision beyond then, or is Dungeon Sagas now this self thing that is like, we've got so much there, that's Dungeon Saga, or is there a vision beyond that, that either you'd like to expand it, so Ronnie wants to go, we're going to head over here and
I think there's
he's just nodding.
Well, I think that I don't see any reason why this should be the end of it. There's a number of other heroes and other adventures, other things we could do. How we end up doing that is, it probably end up being another Kickstarter to do an expanded version of that. That would be my guess, because Kickstarter just makes so much more sense than any other way of doing it. Especially as you'd be tooling a whole load of plastic figures and blah blah blah. So, you know, get very expensive very quickly if you weren't Kickstarting it. So I think that will be a definitely, there's plenty of other things we can come back, other stories we can tell, other heroes we can look at, other bad guys we can look at. Kings of War's got a world to populate, and you don't, not every battle is fought with 1,000 men on each side, so, you know, there's no reason why not. When we would do it is the more interesting question, because as I said, there's a whole load of other exciting things to do, and it's just, you know, where it stands in the line, really.
A quest pack would be, I really hope, and we're working very hard to try and make Dungeon Saga a huge success at retail launch. You know, Dreadball sold 12,000 copies in total now, only 2,000 of which were on the Kickstarter. So we sold it 5-1 retail because of the big plastic range. It's a great game, it's a wonderful tournament system. You know, and starting January, we've got a big Dreadball year coming up because of the Kickstarter last year. But Dungeon Saga, I think there isn't an archetypical miniatures dungeon crawler. Yeah, there's Super Dungeon Explore, which is the kind of fun, light-hearted version. There is Descent, which I think is a very role-play kind of version. It's quite in-depth, it's quite deep. What we're trying to do is the pop out and play, enjoy, almost playing to the archetypes. We're hoping that we're going to be able to get, you know, French and a Spanish and German translations of this at launch, so it's a global product. Which means that we could be able to, and I think it'd be very exciting if we could go back to our retail partners and say, right, we want to do a quest pack, and we're going to tool up specifically for it, it's just for you guys, and we could do fun things like that. And, you know, I think Azure Forest last year was the first non-Kickstarter Dreadball product, and it was really good fun, it was really exciting.
Really popular.
Yeah, absolutely. And it's good flavour, and it kept it going. We realised we were going to be a year without any Dreadball product too, so you thought, well, let's go and do something. So there is capacity there, but it has to have volume if we're going to put 10 sculpts and a plastic tool behind it. You know, it really has to. So as long as this can be as successful as we hope it will be, then it would be wonderful if we could start doing packs and expansions for the, you know, the role-playing angle of it as well. So,
and I think it's all very well to talk about the money in that sense, but I think one of the driving forces behind that is the community that you build when you do a Kickstarter. You get, you know, 6,000 people can now talk to each other on forum. They can compare notes with how much their bank balance hurts after they run Kickstarter. You know, all the things that people do when you Kickstarter stuff. I mean, but it creates an audience that is 6,000 strong before the game hits the shops.
And remember, there was probably 40,000 video views.
And, yeah,
there is a lot of people who saw that but don't quite feel comfortable going in with a Kickstarter.
Absolutely, and then there's all the, you know, often someone buys it and their mates are going to play, you know, and you buy this one and I'll buy the next one. You know, there's all of that. So it's not just 6,000 people, it's 12, 18, however many. And so it's the fact that that's, you get a sort of critical mass of people talking about something and then everyone else wants to come and see what it is. If you've got 100 people buying it, even if they spent the same amount of money, that's still only 100 people talking about it. So I think the number of people in the community so far is really critical to that, and people getting it and then obviously liking it and not saying it's a load of rubbish. But I don't think, you know, nobody has, everybody who's played it says they like it. You know, there's tweaks and there's quibbles and there's FAQs and there's all of that kind of stuff, but you know, people have been playing it and they've been wanting to play the next scenario and they want to try a different hero and they want to try, well, what happens if I'm the wizard and all the rest of it, you know, which is just exactly what you want. Was there a question? I don't know.
Will there be more? I think the answer is yes.
Did we ask?
On a macro scale,
yes.
Lovely, wouldn't it? If we could go and do another whole big thing. On a micro scale, very possible, because it is a self-contained box. We've probably got 2 years worth of releases. But we have found that when you come back to the same product every 6 months and pump something new out for it, so Dreadball, then season two, then season three, it gets bigger. And actually our biggest launch on Dreadball was season three. It really sold well, and it keeps the game in the public eye. And people say, oh, I must try that, you know. Mm. And, you know, I've seen a lot of people today walking out with kind of copies of Dreadball and picking up a team. And, you know, next year we've got a load of really good support for Dreadball because we did the Kickstarter a year ago. The extreme players are like, oh, backers, oh, I've got my stuff. But actually the real work is just about to begin for Dreadball, because there's your hardcore advocates. They've got it, showing it off and talking about it. But if we don't take it out to retail stores and get people playing and doing tournaments, ultimately it's not spreading the hobby and it's not going to do what we need it to do, because there's more people to convert.
There's one other thing about Dungeon Saga that's different from Dreadball in that way. Is that Dungeon Saga with the Adventurous Companion is you the tools to create your own adventures.
Yeah.
And with, as I said, I keep coming back to the idea of there being a large community. That means there are more people who will make their own adventures, put them online, I've written this series of things, blah, 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 blah. Take a piece out of the King's War background, invent their own piece of background, write the story, do the dungeon design. I mean, I was always slightly disappointed with Dwarf King's Hold that there weren't more people coming up with their own scenarios. And that's what an Ancient Grudge was about, it was giving you the tools to do that. But I think it was just, there weren't that many people. And now with Dungeon Saga, we've got many more times that number of people. And so you get this sort of, like I said, critical mass of people talking. Is there enough to have an area on a forum that talks about Dungeon Saga, about people, I've done these scenarios, here are my maps. And I think there should be plenty of content that you guys have made so I can play a game. Well, I get surprised by what's behind the door, because I don't know what's coming. Because I know these ones. You know, I just go, well, yeah, I know what's next. I can do it in my sleep. But it would be really nice for me. So you guys have to go out and do missions, do scenarios. So
next year,
I can play.
Out there, you know, yes, the demo game would be there, but wouldn't it be great that we could see people? And, you know, we're growing up, people could turning up with Dwarven Forge all laid out, some nice scenery from Twisted Catacombs, and running Jake through an adventure.
And if you look at things like the guys have done the
Oil Rig.
The Oil Rig.
Just fantastic.
The Dead Zone Oil Rig. That's just bonkers. Who did the door rig?
Have you not seen it? These guys have built an oil rig from the scenery. It looks really fantastic.
Great,
it's where people are now taking our stuff on and making.
And just something we had not thought of, you know, like what, you know, I hadn't thought of making an oil rig out of it, but it looks great, you know, and you go, wow, what a brilliant thing to do.
Yeah, I think that's where
people can do that with games, can do that with scenarios, giving people the tools to do that with other parts of the game. So whether, you know, in Dungeon Saga, it doesn't need to be a physical thing, it needs to be a conceptual thing, it's an adventure, it's a story, I've come up with these great heroes, I've got these real cool magic items, there's lots of elements where you could easily add your own stuff and join in and take part. So I really do hope there's going to be plenty of that, and then that will make it come alive, I think. And I think for everybody who takes part as well, I mean, that. Just in the same way that when you paint a model, you make it yours. if you design your own scenarios, if you design your own magic items, if you do all that kind of cool stuff, it really makes it yours. Anyway, so.
Good.
Any more for any more?
Campaigns in Dead Zone. You said when you, in the, I think it's in the instruction booklet, that you wanted the campaign to be that anyone could jump in at any time. And I think totally, you absolutely achieve that. But looking at feedback for Dead Zone, I think one of the most common themes that comes up is people wanted something, not necessarily in place of that, but another system as well. How do you feel
another campaign system?
Not necessarily a replacement, but an alternate campaign system. How do you feel about looking at it again?
I'm working on one.
Oh, fantastic! Oh, there you go.
Just next. Because I kind of felt like it was something I wanted to take it, come at it in a different angle, and so I think some of the ideas in that work really well. Some of them work less well. Some of them are kind of traditional things I'm just kind of doing because that's where you always do them. But I wanted to have a look at a slightly different approach, so I've been working on that as well. Yeah. So that's kind of whenever I find a minute to. So, yes.
Jake.
That was a short one.
Oh, sorry, did I
interrupt? No, no.
With Dead Zone, will you do generic mercenaries as opposed to the named characters you've got now, just so people can sort of make their story behind their own mercenary?
That's partly a question for Ronnie about making models, and I'm less happy with that because I think that starts being too much of a kind of allowing people to mini-max stuff. It blurs the edges of where the character is between that's the corporation, that's the Forge Fathers, that's the Rebs. It gives you, if everybody can be the same, then nobody is anything, it's just a sort of grey porridgey mass. When these people are very, very much one thing, they're very expensive, very elite, really good at everything. That's their character. That's the key to the way they work. And to learn how that works is your kind of challenge with that army. And these other guys over here are a bit rubbish at everything, but they're cheap and there's loads of them, and you know, that's their thing. And the more that you can break that, the less character you have. Plus, making generic mercenaries, if they're not Rebs, making generic mercenaries is kind of, what would you make? What would you make that wouldn't be a Rebel figure? That would be a generic mercenary. That would be an interesting model. Bounty hunters, but again, why wouldn't you just do a character bounty hunter? That again, people can, you know, different people can hire. I mean, I think.
Hunters quickly become a faction?
Yeah.
Because I think that would be, you know, I think you go and you say, well, some bounty hunters, why would the bounty hunters be with the plague? The plague are there to kill
them. Money, dinero.
Yeah, I can't see the plague lord sitting down and going, right, Boba Fett. Well, let's negotiate a price here. That's why I think they'd make a faction.
Boba Fett speaks plague, speaks everything.
Okay, Boba Fett excluded.
Okay.
We probably don't have a license to use him, are we? So, you know, there's bounty hunters, whereas you could see bounty hunters absolutely working for a corporation and turning up. They're not Rebs, they're not there to steal equipment and medical supplies, you know. The orcs.
So they're because you pay them.
Correct. And they're there for a specific job, assassinate someone, you know, extract.
Yes.
And that could be a good fun faction. Faction text, that's going to the next Kickstarter.
Or just a twist on the way you play. I mean, they could you could have mercenaries, again, bounty hunters working in a similar way to zombies in two-player games, where they're kind of part of the environment that's doing its own thing, rather than necessarily somebody's stuff. So, I mean, you could have a game. This is off the top of my head, where you could have a game where you're playing it, I'm playing a game, I've got my side, my mission, you've got your side, your mission, and in the middle of it, for Babette, is...
that's good.
It's good, isn't it?
I'm trying to keep him around.
Do you see what I did there?
That's what you did there, that's cool.
He's busy trying to capture one of the characters on one of the sides or other, and you don't know who, or you don't know why, because... You know, maybe his father is a powerful Sith Lord. No. Fish Lord. Back to Fishmen. There is another faction, Fishmen, yes. Anyway, yes, so I think
you're
finding.
You're more than me to it.
I'm allowed to do what I like.
You're seven.
Specifically, I don't think there's a lot of place for that kind of character as a generic. I think characters, when you do characters like that, there's all sorts of opportunity for a story. And generic means no story for me. So I would rather do story in terms of whenever I get a choice, I would rather pick story over generic. And as I tend to be limited in the number of models I can play with, in terms of what's in the range, what's available, and so on. If Ronnie says, I'm coming up with this, I usually go, well, I've got a story we could do with that. So we don't tend to do generic very often. And as I said, I think it's dangerous waters because you start watering down the character of the figure. Of the
Poor chap, just asked a nice question.
It was a good question, and we got two factions and some extra stuff out of it. It was a brilliant question. Most productive question we had today.
There's one here.
You mentioned about Warpath. What's happening with that at the minute?
Warpath, I don't do. These people, I pitched to these people. I did a nice pitch, and they spurned me.
Quite busy, in fairness.
I was quite busy doing other things. But,
so you keep me fairly gave.
No. I'm not doing Warpath. Warpath is Alessio and Stu and
community some other stuff. Yeah. I'll do it very briefly because we can talk about it later in the other one because this is Jake's show. But crudely, as much as Dead Zone has obviously moved the Warpath universe on hugely. We've already got buildings. I don't know if you've seen the parts. Have you seen the 3D printed stuff? Yeah. It's fantastic, isn't it?
Yeah.
So that's going to take it on to another level.
It's gorgeous.
So, breaks the line of sight too. We're going to get some hard plastic vermin out of the next Kickstarter.
You're not keeping up with the Restic then?
No, I mean, always Restic was a mid-ground between hard plastic, which is our basic war game soldier, and then when we were smaller, it was kind of metal for your leaders. And the idea was that Restic would do, and I think it does do a great job, that the abyssal golems, ogres, trolls, where you don't need hundreds of them in your army, but you're on two or three, they're quite large. Restic does that really perfectly. And then I think between Kickstarter, we couldn't get the hard plastic to do what we wanted. We couldn't quite afford to do the volumes, the money didn't allow the volumes to do use Renedra as much as we'd like, so we kind of use Restic quite a lot, and I think we slightly overused it. I'd have liked to have had the four plastic base units in Dead Zone all in hard plastic from the get-go, but the technology wasn't quite there for us to do the digital sculpts into tooling. However, have you seen the Peacekeepers and Enforcers?
Yes, the new models.
Thumbs up, everyone. Yeah,
very good. The shields are very good.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah. Putting them together when we get home.
Yeah, correct. So they're there, the Forge Brothers are there, and the zombies are there. In the next Kickstarter, the vermin are coming that way right from the get-go, as they would have done. Again, the Asterians are going to come in there, and a couple more if it funds up. We'll just keep going. Which means when we come to Warpath, you've got the buildings, you've got your base units, and we can start with vehicles. So the first stretch goals after the
build from
$50 pledge will be the books and things just like Kings of War, but straight away we'll start hitting vehicles because I think that's what it's. If you've seen the flying saucer,
and the giant robot and the flatbed truck, so yeah,
it's there. We've got the technology that's proven. So hard plastic from the get go. Three flyers. If you change the flying saucer, but keep it something that size. Three of those, £20. Bang, you're actually really rocking into that gaming system. We've been playing, it's good, it's about capturing scenery on the battlefield and then defending it, so it's quite funky, it's that interacting, because we thought we've got brilliant scenery, let's use it. Actually, that makes a lot of sense. How would you capture these battlefields? You'd get into those bastion and strong points and defend them, move up, supporting attacks and rate your opponent. So it's got that kind of intuitive feel and so on. So it's progressing. There's probably going to be an alpha rule set during the Dead Zone Kickstarter, so we can actually have a play.
And then give feedback.
Give feedback. Talk about it. Do we like it? We can always put a couple of versions out. We can have the big mass combat version plus a kind of more smaller squad-based individual figure version. If that's what, we're definitely doing that one. And if people say, well, we're on a stepping stone with 50 figures. All right, go here. So I won't talk any more about that. Progressing, and Dead Zone is playing a very big part in making that happen. The stories and the backgrounds.
Cool.
Yeah, 1, 2, 3.
Question for Jake. I work with a bloke who we call the Cornflake Man, because what he does, he comes in and he say, I'll eat my cornflakes for me, and I have an idea. But he pitches an idea, and it sounds bonkers, because generally speaking, two out of three of them are genius. What cornflake ideas have you got floating around in your head at the minute? tell us about.
Most of them are about one of the main projects I don't even have time to do So
on the basis it might be bonkers, but genius.
Well, one of the things that I'm doing, which isn't for Mantic, I mean, this is the thing, is I work for Mantic freelance, so I don't do everything, everything's not for them. And also, some of the stuff I do isn't things Ronnie wants, you know, is interested in. So one of the things that I've been working on for ages is a generic skirmish game called Eternal Battles, where you would need to learn that set of rules and nothing else, because it deals with any period of history and science fiction and fantasy and everything all at once, which is ridiculously complicated in concept, because you've got to fit samurai and space marines and you know, pygmy warriors and everything in it. But I kind of have conflict moments with that every now and again, and I go, oh, that's how you avoid all of that kind of complexity, by just doing this. And so that kind of thing. So that's kind of an ongoing project, and has had, it's probably several bowls full of cornflake moments involved in that. I don't know, it's difficult to say. What they usually are is ways of simplifying things. It's a way of including a whole bunch of stuff that I've wanted to get in without actually making it burdensomely complicated to play. So one of the things I always like, I mean, one of the things I'm proud about with my designs is usually the amount of evolving gameplay you have out of a small number of rules. So the rules are very simple, but they actually quite a lot of implications in the way you've got to play, the way you've got to think about, what you've got to manage, the resources you've got to think about, and the way in which things scale as well. So for example, with Dungeon Sagas, you've got the Necromancer has 12 cards. He's got a deck of 12 cards he plays with. And these are not reusable. One use and they're gone. He can use them once a turn. Some of them will interrupt the hero's go. But these don't come back. He gets an extra one at the end of each turn. He can spend one or two a turn. And the way in which this changes the way you think about it as the game gets bigger, as the scenario gets larger, or as your resources get bigger, is enormous. It's very different effect within different scenarios of the same game with the same rules. And there's a lot more to think about, and the way in which you require to think about different stuff is quite interesting. Or the way in which, because skeletons, the way in which the dice mechanics work means that skeleton warriors are rubbish fighters, but they don't care if you've outnumbered them, got them, you know, attacking them from behind, all the rest of it. There's no rule that says skeletons are undead, they're not interested if you attack them from behind. There's no rule that says they don't care if you outnumber them 10-1. It's just the way the mechanics work. It falls out, but heroes do care. Heroes do, and there's no mechanic that says that specifically. And it's things like that where I'm quite pleased about that, and that was kind of you go, oh yeah, if you did it like this, then you don't need those rules that say skeletons ignore outnumbering, skeletons don't care if they attack from behind. Which in many games, a normal approach would be the rules that said undead models don't care if you hit them from behind, undead, you know, and so on. So it's that kind of thing that I usually would sort of pick on as cornflake moments, ways in which you go, I keep all of the fun bits, but I don't have the rules. They happen, they just are part of the process.
I'm going to slip off in a minute, so if there's anything you want to talk to there.
Of course, enough trouble.
Yeah, well, also I've got the boys and they'll be destroying my office by now, so I'll get saved.
Oh, I did ask them if they were being naughty and they said yes.
Excellent, good lads.
Can I just ask, what are your design space goals for Dead Zone 2? In terms of, is it something that you feel was missing from the first version, or you want to do something slightly different with the factions?
No.
Certain other games,
it's not Dead Zone 2.
Nameless, very much overlap their design space with the same factions, and you get that thing you alluded to, which is the grey porridge between factions.
Yeah, I mean that is always a problem. I think that.
I'll see you all later. Back in.
Thanks, Ronnie.
Thanks, Jake.
It's not Dead Zone 2. I think that's one of the first things to say. Coming back to revisit Dead Zone. Dead Zone? That's the right game, so I get confused. It's a case of what was wrong with Dead Zone, in my view, is that we tried to put too much into too small a space and ended up being a little bit difficult to learn because it was also squashed. And it's not that there's things that are in it are inherently wrong, but there are one or two tweaks, but basically it's fine. It's just that we needed a bit more space to take people through the rules in a more leisurely way and to explain things a bit nicer. And that's why with Dungeon Sagas we've got a lot more room, because we learned that lesson. We've got a lot more space to talk about stuff, a lot more space to put in diagrams and examples and start. So a 1.5 or whatever you want to call it, Dead Zone rulebook will be the same things explained better, in effect. There are one or two places where we can clean up some rough edges and smooth things off and just change things very, very slightly, most of the time in the way we explain them rather than in what they actually do. But that's one of the things I'd be kind of half thinking of the second version of a Dead Zone campaign rules. Might go in there, not sure about that yet, but that might get another version of campaign rules. But it's just a different way of approaching it. That's not necessarily better or worse, it's just different. That kind of thing. So it wasn't the case, so it's not really a case that there's, I think there's lots wrong with it. It's I think that it just needs explaining better. So the mechanical changes will be very, very small, and details that clean things up. Mostly it's a case of incorporating on the FAQ and re-explaining some things. So hopefully they're clearer. That explains, yeah. Yeah? Okay. Who was the next one? I think there were three.
Mars Attacks, basically. The existing Kickstarter has been going on for a year. It's got a year's worth of releases and stuff like that. Is there anything past the year, that year point? Any new material?
Not written at the moment.
Right.
Mars Attacks is a funny one because it's a license.
Yeah.
So you've got to get approval for everything to be a certain way, and you've got to get all sorts of, you know, a lot more hoops to jump through than normal. I'm not sure is the answer, because I think it really depends on how well it's received and what the kind of response is once it's in the trade. You know, once it's out to trade, see how it goes over Christmas. If everybody goes bonkers for it, then we'll do some more. But if they don't, then it will be better for us to focus on Mantic IP in the long run. And to be honest, we've done the sources, the robots, the Nova Sphere, the science division, we've done pretty much everything that's in the IP, all of the big stuff that's in the IP. The Nova Sphere had to practically be made up to go in it by Tops. They were kind of, you know, the guy we were talking to was kind of writing it as we went along, you know, going, I really like these, I made them up, they're great, use these, you know. He was like, but I think most of the IP that is in the Mars Attacks background, bar the odd character here or there, and assuming you don't want us to do KISS, because there's a KISS Mars Attacks comic crossover.
Oh dear.
I didn't believe that when I first heard it, but I've read it, and it's true. heaven help us. Anyway, so there's a few things like that that we haven't done yet, but then we'd have to get their license to use their IP as well, which would be even more complicated. So there's a few bits we haven't done, but by and large, I think we've pretty much crossed all the boxes on Mars Attacks IP, and that what we would be doing is we'd be doing basically a set of more scenarios. So if we're doing something that was like that, although we've already given you quite a lot of, you know, opportunities to, here's how you do the points, here's how you do all this, we could do sort of scenario booklet with some extra stuff in the same way that we've done the Azure Forest kind of extras, a sort of small extra product like that. But really, there's not that much more we could do in terms of extra miniatures, extra factions, without just making it up wholesale. Or doing it in a different period of history, because the Martians have turned up in different times, but then that opens another can of worms, and it didn't seem to be very popular, because all of the IP and the movie and so on is all modern day. So, possibly. But there's nothing to stop you guys making up new scenarios. And there already are. I can't remember how many scenarios there are altogether, but it's a dozen, a dozen and a half, something like that. It's quite, you know, there's a number to be going on with. You could always play Dead Zone. More Dead Zone stuff. So maybe we do some more stuff. We really need to see how it goes, I think is the answer. Because it's not core IP, and we don't know what it's, you know, we've kind of done most of it. Question?
Yeah, actually find myself enjoying playing Mars Attacks a little bit more than Dead Zone. And it's because of that, there's that extra level of complexity in Dead Zone.
Yeah.
And it felt like when I played the Mars Attacks rules, I felt like, wow, if only there'd been this in the Dead Zone rulebook. Like, play it like this first and that with different
levels. But that's what I was saying before. I think that the lack of an explanation and a step-by-step, and this is the basics of movement, and this is the I mean, the guys who have done the Dungeon Saga thing with me today, that's what we're doing with Dungeon Saga. We're saying this is the basic, this has got movement and fighting. Next one's got shooting and magic. Now put it all together. And that's what we're doing in Dungeon Sagas, and that's what the lesson we took from the first one was that wasn't right. We didn't do that right. We didn't teach it to people the right way, in a simple enough kind of step-by-step process. And the next one, when we come back with the vermin, we will be doing that, definitely saying, here's just get on the table, here's movement and shooting, don't worry about anything else. Don't worry about 3D, don't worry about melee, don't worry about anything else. Just take these guys and run around and shoot for a bit. Okay, right, now you know that. Right, here's some melee, here's 3D, here's how that works. And then build it up in steps in that way. Because I think you're quite right. I mean, absolutely, that is one of the things that showed us was, hang on, this works really easily. Like, people get this in a way that they didn't get that. Why was this? And kind of just thinking about what the process was. So yes, I'm sure that experience is quite common. And I think that it's not a lack of the way people's affection for Dead Zone when they get past that hurdle. Mm. But it just, that hurdle is unnecessarily high, and that we can make it smaller. So, hence 1.5.
You touched on IPs just now. Mm-hmm. You had a Judge Dredd crossover with Mars Attacks.
You did.
Are we going to see any Dredd in Dead Zone as a possible faction?
Dredd Zone.
Or hero? Dredd Zone. It'd be amazing.
It would be a snappy title, wouldn't it? I don't know. I've not heard any more about that one. It's possible. It's an odd thing because it's just kind of it's one of those things where for some people it breaks the IP of the game itself. It isn't. See, personally, I probably wouldn't use it because it's I like the IP being an IP. That's one story.
Yeah.
Dread is another story, and I wouldn't necessarily want to mix them up. But I know people do, and we use. You know, I've played various games with that kind of thing in it, so it's certainly possible. They were quite happy for us to do that with Mars Attacks and kind of got the joke in it. But that was because it was already done in the comics.
Yeah.
So they already had that link and that made sense. But having made that connection, then maybe we'll be able, you know, it will be kind of fun to do Dread turning up in. The universe is a big place. You never know where you'll turn up next. So it's possible. I don't know is the answer.
Fantastic.
So.
Thank
you. Any more for any more? Come back to you in a sec. Next, yeah?
Yeah, you mentioned the Azure Growth Pack a couple of times.
Yep.
Are there plans for any more of those?
The idea was that they would be annual. Well, that was the original idea for that Azure Forest Pack, was that would be each year there would be a sort of tournament spin on the way tournaments were done for that year. So I haven't heard otherwise, is what I could say to that. I expect there will be, yes. I'm not sure whether I will be writing all of them, but I think they definitely, because a lot of people, I mean, the more you do of this, the more you talk to people, the more you go, why don't you guys write some adventures so I can play? Eventually somebody listens, and somebody does, and somebody does their own adventure packs and tournament packs, and the more people play, the more people are playing Dread Ball tournaments around the world, the more someone's going to come up with a cool idea or a way of playing it, and go, yeah, well, just, why not play that? That's great, that looks like fun, why not we do that? So I'm sure we will see more of that kind of thing. As I said, the original idea was that there would be one for each year's worth of kind of tournament theme. And Ronnie haven't told me that's not true anymore. That's what I'm saying, because I'm being filmed. So if it's not true, then it's not my fault. As Alessio once told me, there's a great Italian phrase, I wasn't there, and if I was, I was sleeping. sorry, we're gonna ask this chap next.
You mentioned, in a minute. You mentioned in your blog some potential playtesting changes to the way jacks work.
Yes.
How has that been received so far? Because in Chester, it's been received really well, and we're implementing them in our game.
Well, the very, very long thread on that post is kind of basically a lot of people took it as, oh, change jacks. Well, here's my idea, which was actually interesting but not terribly helpful in checking that one. Because in playtesting, I don't think people really realise how long-winded and often tedious playtesting can be, because you do something till you break it, and then you fix it, and then you do it again, and you keep doing that. But if you're not doing the bit, testing the bit you're testing, then it's not really pertinent, and it may be brilliant, but you've got to finish this one first. So we got and there's a lot of people since have come back and said, I've tried this and I've tried that, and there's various different people who have tried different things. I think it's not quite right. I have an updated version of my next version of it to post, which is two-thirds the same and a little bit different. But I think that's how it works. It's kind of iterative. That's kind of how that process is. But at the same time, because the game is live and lots of people are playing it and so on, which is useful because people can playtest it, but not, it makes you very cautious about making big changes. Unless something is radically not right that you need to fix now. And I think some people say it's okay, some people are happy with it, some people aren't, blah, blah, blah. It needs fixing at some point, and I will get to there, but I want it to be right when I get there.
Repackaging it all, that's going to be a difficult issue, isn't it? If you make enough changes that you had to let everyone be aware of those changes.
Well, I think it's one of those things. If people aren't aware of them, they can still play the game. It's not, the game's not broken as it stands. They can still play as it stands. And the people who are really into it and play leagues every week and all the rest of it, they will know, because they're the kind of people who will look on my site on BGG and all the rest of it, and they will dig it out. People who play tournaments will largely know, because the tournament pack includes the additions and so on. So I don't mind there being that, because I don't think those two groups come into contact lots, and if they do, there's a very easy transfer of information. This now works like that, that's a plus one, not a plus two. Oh, okay, fine. So it's not complicated in that way. I think that the important thing is that, as I said, it works as it stands. They're just not quite what I wanted them to be. And I think that's fine. I understand people think that. And it's quite distracting. It's fine as it stands. It works as it stands. It could be improved. So I'd like to improve it, but I want to make sure when I improve it, I don't make it worse or just make it differently broken. Because there's no point in changing stuff and it not actually be right. Because that's, there's now two different wrong versions out in the world. I mean, that's not going to help anybody.
That's what a different company does, isn't it?
So exactly how we do it when I get the right version, when we get a version that because all of the people are never happy, but most of the people think, is about right, then great, that's what we'll go with. But, I mean, as I said, the idea of putting up something on the website that's experimental rules is basically to say, these are not official, these are still being tinkered with. And it's your chance to kind of join in with this process of how do we move this onwards. So there are other elements as well I'll get to, but I'm trying to get sort of narrow people's focus to say, look at this bit now. Let's sort this bit now. And then when we've sorted that bit, we'll look at this bit over here. Good question. So, Daniel's question.
Where do you get your inspiration for game mechanics, be it like historical accounts or modern warfare or movies or computer games?
All of those. Mostly the way I tend to work is from thinking about the story of whatever it is I'm trying to do. So how does the thing I'm trying to model work? What's the story about? How does that work in both in a kind of macro sense and in a detail? What's the distinct thing about that process that's not? Why is sword fighting different from shooting people with guns? What's the difference in that? How should magic work? What are the key things about magic? How do I want to present that? And then honing that down till you get what the kind of the nub of that might be. So, for example, in Dungeon Saga, the ability, having piles of bones and being able to resurrect them, is a really key thing to being a necromancer. Is the idea of that, our whole idea. There's loads of things you could do about being necromancers, but that's one of the kind of kernels of necromancy, is raising the dead. But the idea of being able to do that within the context of the game kind of hammers that home. It's not just that I've got an army of undead, because in most games you've got an army of undead and there's like little bits here and there, maybe you can raise the odd skelly, but it's never very much more than 5% of your army is raised in the process of playing. Whereas in Dungeon Saga, you can often go through the same models again and again and again. So you have four on the table at once, but you have 12 altogether. You go through, that becomes a major part of how it works. Mechanically, it's very simple. You say, that pile of bones, right, raise them up, there you go, there's Skelly. Very, very simple. But it carries the story very easily, and it comes from the story. So I did a game about ants. There's several games about ants, several board games about ants. And the game I did about ants was entirely based on the way they moved. when you saw an ant. I was looking at an ant's nest and I thought they move in a way that most animals don't move. They clamber over each other, they basically ignore each other when they're moving. They treat each other as part of the scenery when they're moving. I thought, that's quite an interesting idea, because nothing else moves like that. Fish don't move like that, cows don't move like that, you know, people don't move like that. Nothing else moves that way, and I thought that would be an interesting hook for a way of playing a game, because that would give you a different movement from anything else you're playing with, because everything else moves in you know, the same way, pretty much. So it's that kind of thing. It's just kind of something will strike me as being different or interesting or unusual or whatever, and it's trying to get to the nub of whatever that might be. You know, the boil it down and boil it down, and what's the core of what makes that tell that story? How does that story work? I suppose that's it. I mean, it's that you look at whatever it is you're trying to model, whether it's a clash of armies or a spaceship dogfight game or whatever, and you think, what makes that thing? What's that core of that? Because I tend to do quite short rule sets with quite simple rules, and it's trying to refine those down and then have them, as I was saying before to you, is have each bit do multiple jobs and interact in ways that encourage you to play in ways that make you think in ways that reflect the way in which you deal in on the game, on the tabletop. So, I mean, for example, I mean, there's another example from tabletop gaming, figure gaming. I generally prefer games where you have to guess ranges rather than measuring ranges in advance, because I think that in terms of being a general, you don't know how far away something is exactly, ever. Even now, I was watching a documentary about the elite training of the American snipers in the Marines. Ridiculously well trained by the most overfunded army in the world. And they say, we have all these great gizmos for measuring range. Don't trust them. We need to teach you how to guess the range as accurate as possible. So nobody believes these things are going to survive. So in that context, to put you more in the position of the commander, I think you shouldn't be able to have a pre-knowledge about what the range is. Okay. Missed the time today. Now you're saying off 5 minutes, so that's 7 questions. anyway, so, yes, so, there you go. So, do we have any more questions? Maybe two if we're lucky.
Have you got any further concepts in King's War Skirmish? Because there was talk on the last item day about maybe some vampire castle with 3D scenery. And...
No.
Well, that was quick.
Can you tell me the difference about, like, there's the Dead Zone's D8 system and everything else seems to be D6.
Yep.
When you're designing a game, what were the pros and cons of using a D8 or using a D6?
Basically, I would use the appropriate dice for the mechanics that I'm trying to do. All other things being equal, I would always use 6-sided dice, because they're the things people are most familiar with, and what I want to do is to make the mechanics disappear so you can involve yourself in the tactics and the whole story of the game. So using things people are familiar with means they can ignore them more easily. So sixes are always better. However, when you go to the value of more dice, more sides on the dice, is you get a wider spectrum of not so much odd results when you roll the dice, but as it allows you to give you more variation with your stat line in the style of mechanics I'm using. It'd be 6 plus to succeed, 4 plus to succeed style of mechanics, because that is a stat as well as a result. You need more space on the dice range to have a wider range of stuff. So when I went to Dead Zone, I was thinking, well, I want to have a wider variety of stats because of the number of different factions I've got, and then because science fiction gamers tend to be a bit more tech nerds, and they want lots of different guns, and they want lots of different aliens, and they want all this kind of stuff, which fantasy doesn't tend to do in the same way, and which in Dreadball you can get away with because it doesn't need to work that way. You don't need that detail of varying equipment. And because each of the teams have got basically 3 or maybe 4 at most different stat lines, you know, it's very, very minimalist. Dead Zone was never going to be that minimalist, and so needed just that extra bit. But going from 6 to 8, you get those 2 extra pips to play with the stat. Because you never, when you get a 6-sided dice, you never use 1, or you never use 6. Well, you occasionally use 6, but you don't use the ends very much. You're really talking about the middle. And so going from 6 to 8 gives you 50% more stat, because you've gone from 4 to 6. Yeah? So, and if it need, and I thought, well, do I need, I tried using it with D10s, I said, do I need D10s? I tried using it, I thought, well, I don't really need all that space. 8 is sufficient, I don't need the extra. Whereas with Eternal Battle, I was talking about before, that is now D10s. That started on 6s and ended, I needed 10s because I needed the variation. But it would it needs what it needs, is the answer. And I think it's being aware that it might need something different. You know, so you're open to that and you go, well, let's just try it. And different mechanical approaches would be able to get away with different dice. So I could use D6 for everything if I used a different approach. Don't be afraid of the D8. He's not knocked again, so that's one more question. If you've got any at the back there.
So, with the recent Dreadball, there's a whole lot of new races introduced. If you had to pick one to add to Denzin, what would it be?
Ooh, that's a question I have to think. That's not good.
Crystal Guys.
Crystal Guys are interesting. I quite like, I mean, the two I think are more entertaining than the Crystal Guys are the guys that phase in and out. I can't remember that, probably called phases. They were called phases in the rough, I can't remember what they got called in the end. And the Chorus, who have the little mini warp jumps. So the little warp hole projectors that they can go in and out of. And they're kind of fun. But they're very like, I mean, see, the thing is, they're very like Corralon out of whatever that game was called. Can't remember the name of it now. There was a game with Corralon with aliens in that did very much that kind of thing. So that would be kind of repeating that. So possibly the guys with phase, because they're interesting, because they come and go. They're either substantial or insubstantial depending on what's going on. And so in a fight that can make them quite hard to hit. But you know, it could be an interesting way of doing it so they could move through terrain and, you know, never mind the actual physical fighting values of that. The ability to be able to move through buildings as if they're not there on a tabletop battlefield could be quite interesting. Especially if Ronnie's saying they're making more out of buildings being important. So we're behind these thick walls, these in this bunker, and they can just walk through them. That's not good. you know, so that would be, I think that's kind of a lot of play. And again, I keep going back to the word story because that's what I really like. That tells so much. I mean, immediately, as soon as you go, we're behind our bunker, these guys can walk through walls. Oh. Then your brain's gone, and that, you know, and you can see the scene in your head, and you can see the, you know, as he phases through the wall, and everybody goes, "What?" And all of a sudden, you guys, you know, he's taken over bunkers with one guy because he just turns up. Anyway, you can see what I mean about story. I like story. I like stuff that goes, that puts images in your head, that tells the movie. That you can see the movie, and you go, "Oh, I just yeah, that means that this, you know, and so on." Still no reply? No, okay. Oh, I'm happy to stand here and babble all day. You're not going to come and remind us. So, question.
So, in the, I've had a look through the lovely PDF of the Dreadball Extreme. I like what I saw, definitely.
Okay.
One thing I was quite surprised was that there was no mention of any of the Dreadball original teams.
Yeah.
And not as many sponsors as I was expecting to see. I was expecting to see more of it. It's not, it looks like it's all standalone, but there's other stuff to come.
This is the thing about the sort of core that makes it straightforward and start to start with, and then expanding that with more weird and wonderful things. Expanding that with more weird and wonderful things later. So there are more four more sponsors, I think, and a whole bunch more teams. More, it's not so much more teams; it's more players.
Do the existing sponsors get the ones that you do? Do they get more access to more of the other other stuff? So
yeah,
their list is going to be extended.
Yeah. Well, it's not a list because they don't work. The list is a shorthand from the full system because there are only two of them and they're only working with a very limited set of people. That is a shorthand where I did all the workings out for you. Actually, the full system is a different approach. Well, it's the full approach that's. Start again. The way in which DBX sponsors work in the full version, there's not the core. The core box is the kind of the result of this, but the equation is how many groups does the sponsor and the player have in common? And the player has three different costs. If he doesn't like you at all, he'll cost a lot more than if he's your best mate. So that's why the same player costs different amounts for different sponsors in the first game, because they have different numbers of groups in common. So basically what you do is you simply say, I share one group, the default is one group. So I know some of the same people that he knows, so we kind of know each other vaguely, so I get a reasonable rate. And then it's more or less than that. So if I know nobody, then he charges more. And if I know lots of the things, we move in all the same circles, then I get a discount.
Right, so that will allow you to basically create your own sponsors then?
All you would have to do with sponsors is you would have to say he has this many groups he works with and so on. It would be very simple.
Sounds good.
Very straightforward. But it means that you can't shorthand the whole thing for everybody because you'd have to list all the possible. You would get a huge list of everything for every single sponsor, which would take up some groups. I think we probably better had go, otherwise he's probably standing outside being upset. Is there any more desperate, urgent things, or are you all boiled in the bag quite enough? Yeah. Excellent. Right, well, thank you very much for coming. And you may all escape through the valve here.
Hey guys, hope you've just enjoyed that video. Mammoth long one, so we won't take you long. We won't. Thank you for watching. We'll see you another time.
Until next time.